No more ransomware payments? A Linux malware framework and a UEFI rootkit was spotted in the wild. All that coming up now on ThreatWire. Greetings, I am Shannon Morse and this is ThreatWire for August 2nd, 2022. This is your summary of the threats to our security, privacy, and internet freedom. I have a special announcement. I will be at DEF CON, which is next weekend. It's coming up so fast. I'll be filming an entire special episode of ThreatWire. I'm gonna be there for the entire convention and I'm also having a meetup. Now, I am getting those plans set up this week, so keep an eye on my social media for details. I'm at Snubs, which is spelled S-N-U-B-S on Twitter and Instagram. Thank you so much for supporting my content in whichever way you do it. I seriously cannot wait to meet y'all at DEF CON. I hope you can go. If you will be there, definitely shout me out if you see me walking around the convention. Let's go ahead and get started with today's news. In July of 2016, a project which is called No More Ransom was launched as an online portal and a public/private partnership that was started by Europol, the Dutch National Police, Kaspersky, and McAfee. This law enforcement/IT security partnership paved the way to help people decrypt ransomware data by offering a go-to place for decryptors. Now, at first, they only had 4 decryptors available, but now they have over 100 free keys. No More Ransom now has 188 partners worldwide, and they just announced that they have helped over 1.5 million people with free decryption tools for recovering files. Now, this has saved, according to last year's numbers published by Europol, almost €1 billion since victims would not have had to pay that money to cyber criminals. Now, No More Ransom has this crypto sheriff tool, which asks you to upload 2 encrypted files plus the ransomware note in order to find a match. If one exists on their database, they give you the proper decryptor and instructions on how to accomplish that task. If there is not some kind of match, they recommend checking back since it is constantly updated with new decryption keys. No More Ransom is a positive piece of news today because they have been advocating for better access to decryption keys, raising awareness around ransomware attacks, and offering easy-to-use direction for normal folks to follow. The project does have some recommendations for combating ransomware before it even hits your system as well. For example, backup regularly, practice good online security hygiene, i.e. don't click on weird links, don't open sketchy attachments, and keep your systems up to date as well as your software, use 2-factor authentication, and for corporations, limit the possible threat vectors. And lastly, don't pay that ransom. Paying ransoms for encrypted files leads to financing of future attacks, so taking precautionary approaches can save you a lot of stress and potentially a lot of money in the long term. Frameworks are very common parts of development for software because they keep everything clean and organized, including but not limited to things like libraries, image files, logging, and authentication. This platform can make it easier for developers to quickly deploy apps and updates for multiple ecosystems. So they are common. Now, an undocumented malware framework for Linux was just discovered and revealed by security firm Intezer last week after they found it on VirusTotal. The malware was submitted by a Chinese manufacturer who was running CentOS. This malware framework is called Lightning Framework and is used as a post-exploit malware. It's installed on an infected machine after the attacker has already gained some sort of access and is used to install rootkits and run plugins. Since frameworks are so common for development, what is it that makes this one unique? Well, according to Intezer, it is rare to see a framework so intricate meant to target Linux systems. In the case of Lightning, it's a modular framework with a lot of capabilities. An attacker could use this to make the infected machine communicate with their own server, open a secure shell, and submit commands. The data compiled so far is a very small part of the framework, so they are still analyzing everything that Lightning Framework can do. In their blog post, the researchers mention that they do not have all of the files mentioned in the framework, but they hope to obtain the full scope of the framework by publicly sharing the information that they have gathered so far. Biggest of shoutouts to my Hush Puppy Perk Level patrons for sharing their fur baby photos and for the support. I love them, they're so cute. Thank you so much for sending them in. And a huge thank you to my newest patron, SSH17Haxer. Now, I'm not pronouncing your name fully because I'm pretty sure that LeetSpeak cannot be translated on YouTube, and I don't wanna get in trouble with the YouTube overlord, so we're just gonna go with that. But thank you so much for joining the Alliance on patreon.com/threatwire. Let's go ahead and finish out today's episode with my last top story all about UEFI rootkits. And yes, I do like to say UEFI. If you prefer UEFI, that's fine. I'm gonna go with UEFI. I think it's cute and it's kind of Final Fantasy, so we're just gonna go with it. Are UEFI rootkits rare? Well, according to Kaspersky, maybe not. Last week, the security company posted an article about Cosmic Strand, which is a supposedly Chinese-based rootkit that targets the Unified Extensible Firmware Interface, the UEFI, instead of targeting the operating system or the firmware. Now, since the UEFI is the first thing to boot whenever a computer is turned on, it's hard to detect, test for, and inspect this tiny little storage chip, since it also affects what happens after it boots up by influencing how your operating system, your AV apps, for example, and software and firmware will run. Kaspersky says that Cosmic Strand has been used in the wild since 2016. Now, this is backed up by a report by Kihoo360 in 2017, which also explained the same rootkit, just a very early variant. Now, Kaspersky's findings explain how Cosmic Strand infects firmware images on Gigabyte and ASUS motherboards, and in an email with Ars Technica, they explain that this may or may not be a bootkit depending on where it is installed. Now, in Kaspersky's analysis, they explain the steps involved for Cosmic Strand to succeed. It first bootstraps the whole chain, then it sets up a malicious hook in the boot manager to modify the Windows kernel loader before execution. This allows attackers to set up another hook function in the kernel. Now, that function can later be called during startup of the operating system, and the malware then deploys a shellcode in memory and contacts the C2 server to retrieve a malicious payload. So far, Kaspersky notes that they have seen the rootkit running on machines in China, Vietnam, Iran, and Russia, and they do not seem to target any specific industry. The infected machines were likely private citizens, not companies. My YouTube channel is youtube.com/ShannonMorse for everything from tech reviews to security tutorials, and I have got a Pixel 6a review in the works right now. I have it in hand already, and it's a pretty good phone. I'm super excited to share that review with you. Do not forget to like and subscribe to Hack5 as well. I'm Shannon Morse, and I'll see you on the internet.